G'day mates, it's B-Buster here, and I would like to give Cerebral a big shout out for sponsoring this episode. So, mental health is incredibly important in everyone's life. And did you know that last year rates of anxiety and depression doubled in the US? And with therapy visits costing over $100 per session, in my mind the system just isn't keeping pace with the needs of our communities. Enter Cerebral. Cerebral is an online mental health service that offers prescription medication, counseling, and therapy for anxiety, depression, ADHD, insomnia, and more. I know from personal experience with family members the difference that therapy can make for the lives of others. The quest for self-improvement is a steep one, but it's well worth the effort. It's commendable to receive a helping hand in order to work at being the best version of yourself. And with Cerebral, you can make that step today. With Cerebral, you can connect with your counselor and therapist on your own schedule through your laptop or the Cerebral mobile app. You can schedule sessions based on what's most convenient for you. You don't have to wait weeks to be seen, and they're also one of the few services that provides prescription medications online through a licensed provider and ships medication straight to your door so you can skip the pharmacy lines. The treatments are affordable at only one-third of the traditional price, and for listeners of this program, you can receive 65% off your first month of medication management and care counseling at getcerebral.com/bescaredpod. Go to getcerebral.com/bescaredpod for 65% off your first month. That's just a total of $30 to get started. Join Cerebral today on their mission to make quality mental health care accessible and affordable for all. So, I'm a tradie in my 30s, and I have a female partner that is a bit younger than me. I live in Queensland, Australia, and last year during Christmas holidays, we decided to have a 10-day trip with a camper van around state. After exploring the beach side of the state, we decided to go inland. We camped overnight in a lookout over a gorge with a great view. There were two more campers, so not a busy spot. Unfortunately, though, it started raining, so we waited to explore the next day. It started to get dark, and when we woke up, I saw that the number of the campers didn't change as rain continued during the next day. That was a bit disappointing, but we still decided to go explore the top of the mountain range, a long narrow hilltop that was a short distance from the camping spot, just a few minutes walking. Our destination was probably only about maybe an hour there and back, and had some man-made stairs at the beginning of the trail. They were basically just rocks, but there were also big stones positioned in sort of the natural tiles in the ground every now and there. Not in a regular pattern or anything, random and scarce, but I would estimate they'd probably weigh about 100 kilos and were mostly flat with the rest of the terrain deep in the ground. On both sides of the narrow range were very steep sides, definitely not accessible, but they had a great view of the surrounding dense forests all the way that you could see anyway. What I'm trying to paint here is that, basically, we were in the middle of nowhere. The way to the end of the range, though, was through some obstacles, where I had to help my girlfriend climb up some big rocks and other stuff. Once we made it to the end, there was a sharp end and a drop-off into the gorge beneath. But we took some pictures and decided to go back to our RV eventually. We still haven't seen or heard anyone, and the path from the beginning to the end was very narrow with the visibility of both sides, so no one could have walked past us. Of course, there were trees and other obstacles on the path, but we could not see much back from where we came from, but what we noticed on the way back were some of those large stones mentioned before, they were missing. You could see the fresh holes in the ground too, and we definitely would have seen them missing on the way in the first time, as there was only one way there and back. I would say that there were about maybe 10 plus of them missing across the whole way back, and they were not from the same spot. There were maybe, I don't know, 50 altogether, randomly positioned. For the life of me too, I just cannot explain how someone could like dig them up and carry them back to their truck or something in that time. And I mean, even if someone decided that they wanted it in their garden or something, it's just not humanly possible to lift them like that. Now, this experience was, I think, the next day or maybe the one after in a different place of the same national park. It was called Carnarvon National Park. It's a massive range connected to other state forests and parks and whatnot. The weather didn't improve either, and we didn't see many people in our next destination either. There were only two or three cars on which is usually a very popular spot. We decided to take a hike anyway of one of the indicated routes showed on the map. Most were leading to different parts and some even divided further. I would guess that we were about 3 hours in and we decided that we'd had enough combined with the weather and seen what we wanted to, and so we were about to turn back when we walked past a route that was blocked off by a sort of fencing and with a warning sign that said closed due to flooding and inaccessible road. It was a route that would stretch for another 20 kilometers, but I've seen that there was a small waterfall just close, maybe around 1 kilometer away that way, so I persuaded my girlfriend to go. She was hesitant at first, not trusting the sign, but eventually she agreed. We walked around the blocked entrance easily, was only walking around a few trees to the side, and continued on the path. I should mention too that I carry a machete in my backpack along with some emergency stuff like snacks and water. Call me paranoid, but hey, I'd rather have it and not need it than need it and not have it, right? Anyway, after about 20 or 30 meters of walking, we reached that little waterfall. On the way there, there were some fallen trees on the path that we had to climb over as walking around just wasn't always possible. It started to drizzle again, a bit stronger this time, so we decided to go back after we reached our destination. We took a few pictures, spent a few minutes. I will say again that we did not see anyone that day, since the handful of people at the beginning of the car park at the very bottom, they went a different route. We started walking back after a few minutes when I just suddenly felt this feeling like we were being watched. In fact, I stopped and felt the hair on my arm standing up. It was a feeling like something wanted to harm us. Now, my girlfriend doesn't really believe stuff like that, and definitely doesn't understand why I would carry a machete into the forest, unless planning to cut through the jungle, of course, but this is Australia. We don't have access to guns like you guys do in the States. So I told her that we should go faster, and that I just don't feel safe. After a few minutes of walking with me constantly looking around, I stopped and decided to take my Crocodile Dundee knife out. Once I did this, I decided to whistle. I don't know why, maybe it was to just break the silence, to maybe scare something away, and not like we have bears here or anything. It wasn't a long tone whistle, but rather a few short melodic sort of like whistles. And at first, nothing happened, so we continued walking with my knife in hand, and after a very short time, I would say 10 seconds, we then heard the same whistle come back at us. Now, the visibility from the footpath is quite decent being on the bottom between the hills like this, going along a small creek, and I can tell you that there was no one that we could see. My hair on my arm started to raise again, and my girlfriend finally acknowledged that something just wasn't right and started walking fast without me hustling her. I think she felt it too, but we had to make it to the entrance section that was blocked and then back to the main track without any further incident. And all the way there, I felt just like I was being watched and not wanted there at all. As soon as we did make it to the normal trail, all feelings of being threatened subsided. And eventually, we made it back, and we just packed up, and we left. Me and my girlfriend live in a calm and small city, so we're used to walking alone, even late at night, from her house to mine, or vice versa. A few years ago, when we were 18 or 19 years old, we were going to her house alone, walking. There was nobody on the streets, and it was starting to get dark at this point. We were chatting about something and making jokes when we decided to walk by a different route, just to change the usual path up a bit. We were walking for 15 minutes, more or less, when we started to feel a little lost and thought, hey, this isn't the way home. And at this same instant, too, we heard a loud whistle as someone was whistling to get our attention. We turned back and we saw this, well, clown. He was there, standing still, looking at us and smiling, but something was really off. His clothes were kind of ragged. He had three balloons floating, tied to his hand, and in the other hand, he had a huge butcher's knife. We thought that it was some kind of a joke at first. Like, it seemed to be out of a horror movie or something. I said, "Hello, how are you?" because I really didn't know what to do. He then proceeds to whistle a kid's song and walk slowly towards us. Well, as you might have figured too, we were terrified by this and we started to back up a bit, and then we ran away from that thing. He didn't run though, at least, well, we didn't see him run, but every time that we thought that we were away from it, he would just reappear around the corner of another street. We couldn't find anybody else in the streets, and it was getting dark at this point. We ran again and hid behind some trees for half an hour or more. Then we proceeded to look for the right path back to a house, and we saw him once again when we were already far from the place that we had hid. But he had his back to us at this point, so he didn't see us. After that, we thought, well, it must have been someone just playing a prank on random people or something. But we then saw on the news a week later that someone had been attacked by a clown. Not severely hurt, thankfully, but still. The police were looking for this clown, but couldn't find him anywhere. I hazard a guess that in our small town, that it must have been the same person.